The opening months of the 4 years' war went very badly for the Federation. As explained in part one, linked in the video description, years of skirmishes led to the 4 years' war with the Klingons some years before Kirk captained the Enterprise in the original series. This is a story told by the writers of the Star Trek role-playing game by FASA Corp in the 1980s. As I tell this condensed version of events, please keep in mind that there are many, many events that occur in the source material that I'm unable to cover, otherwise this would be a very lengthy series that I don't have time and the resources for. So this is a shortened version, and it'll have to suffice for now. Picking up from part one, the Klingons had secretly occupied the planet Axanar, deep inside Federation space, in an effort to gain a foothold before their full-scale invasion. But before the Klingons could fortify their position, the incursion was discovered by Captain Garth of Izar, and the Klingon reinforcement fleet was soundly defeated due to superior tactics. The First Battle of Axanar officially triggered the 4 years' war. But unaware of this, the Klingons proceed with their invasion with several squadrons of 50 or more ships each, with the iconic D7A as the core ship class of their invasion fleets. These fleets easily defeated the thin Starfleet defense line at the border in the initial battles, and there was nothing to stop their march into Federation territory. Meanwhile, Garth of Izar moves his squadron into Axanar and finishes off the Klingon forces there, consisting of some D4 cruisers and D16 destroyers, as well as a T3 assault vessel that was used to occupy the planet. Once the escorts were dealt with, the Klingon assault ship is pulled from the planet with a tractor beam. This T3 assault ship later became a war trophy in the Starfleet Space Flight Museum on Luna. The Klingons wasted no time initiating the first ground combat on Johnny 4 by landing troops, easily subjugating the planet. Although many of the Klingon commanders lacked tactical skill, they made up for this with savagery and relentless aggression. In almost every early engagement, the Klingons enjoyed a 3 or 4 to 1 numerical advantage. Several ship classes on both sides proved to be useful or useless in combat, too many for me to list here, and there are many that aren't even illustrated in the FASA material. The Klingons' D7s proved themselves to be a solid design, while the old D16 destroyers began to fall into disfavor. As the war along the front continued, Captain Robert April, who was the first captain of the Enterprise, was quietly retired. It later became known that he was unhappy with how the Arcanus massacre was handled by Starfleet, and the general withdrawal of Starfleet along the front. But rather than cause the morale problem with the vocal opposition, he took an honorable retirement instead. He thought a more aggressive stance should have been taken against the Klinks in the opening months of the war. But part of this was Starfleet's major concerns over the Romulans, who might enter the war on the side of the Klingons or simply take advantage of Starfleet's vulnerability. Therefore, many of the ships that might have been used to defend against the Klingons were deployed to the Romulan neutral zone. The first major engagement between Klingon ground troops and Starfleet Marines occurred at the Battle of GR-TAC 1, where the Klingons invaded Nausicaa 7. The Andorian general Shruth put up a valiant defense. While the Klingons attempted to slaughter the inhabitants and ground troops from orbit, the general tried to board the orbiting ships. This attempt failed. The Klingons devastated the planet through bombardment and were able to easily install a garrison there without any real ground resistance. This was a dark time of the war for the Federation. One of the few bright spots involved an incident with an Orion merchant convoy carrying dilithium crystals, an essential component for warp drives. Whichever side controlled this would tip the balance of the war. The Klingons tried to attack these neutral Orion merchants, The Orions would have none of this and opted to destroy their own ships rather than let them fall into Klingon hands. The formal statement by the Orion colonies to both sides about this incident was as follows. All dilithium shipments to all governments are considered sacred cargo, not to be captured, destroyed, or diverted. This served to preserve Orion neutrality and protect the dilithium industry in spite of the war. Although Starfleet continued to make concessions on the heated war front, they increased ship production on the back end away from the front. Supply convoys that fueled the ship production effort often mysteriously disappeared. This stunted the production of these ships. It was clear the Klingons were very good at hunting down Federation convoys deep inside Federation space. Unescorted convoys would be attacked by small Klingon raiding parties without consequence. Starfleet began to enforce shipping zones and restrictions on where and when civilians can fly their shipments. Many merchant captains weren't happy with these restrictions, but the result yielded a decrease of missing cargo ships, allowing the Federation to begin outproducing the Klingons when it came to ships. This ramped up production led to the first use of Starfleet's new Lochnar-class frigates, which were a streamlined fighting ship with combat abilities that rivaled even a Constitution-class ship. The Nostveg engagement using Lochnars ended in a great victory, and Starfleet was able to capture several Klingon ships. This marked the first major strategic defeat of the Klingons. The war thus far had seen only minor engagements on planet surfaces between ground troops. Starship bombardment or interception left little room for costly ground battles until the Battle of Sinbad 4. Starfleet intelligence learned that the Klingons planned to seize this resource-rich planet. Federation frigates were able to intercept much of the assault fleet in advance, and only a fraction of the Klingon assault fleet was able to reach the planet. The Klingons tried to land their troops anyway, as they were attacked in orbit. The Federation Marines were able to capture 30,000 crack Klingon ground troops. With these victories, Starfleet began to threaten the overstretched Klingon supply lines, vital to keep their invasion deep into the Federation marching forward. Starfleet would be in for a nasty surprise, however, when threatening these Klingon shipping lanes with the first use of gravitic mines deployed by Klingon D-16s. The use of mines would be an unusually defensive tactic for Klingons. Perhaps this was the first sign of overextension by the Klingon forces. The time finally came when Starfleet believed their fleet doctrine, in spite of still being slightly outnumbered, had gained superiority over the Klingons, with the new Lochnars and Larson-class ships supplementing Anton-class cruisers. The Constitution-class cruisers would make rare but powerful appearances at this time. But we mustn't be careful not to underestimate Klingon engineering, who adapted their doctrine as well. Their new D-10s were often more than a match for the Constitution-class cruisers or Lochnar-class frigates, and began to serve as command cruisers. And the answer to the Lochnar class was somewhat rare but very effective, the L6 Defender class, one of my personal favorite Klingon ship designs. This causes Starfleet to controversially withdraw its most valuable assets, the Constitution class cruisers, including the one we know best, the Enterprise. They were concerned that they may actually be challenged, destroyed, or captured by these larger and more powerful Klingon ships. The Enterprise and others were sent back out to exploration, first contact missions, etc., but they were the most powerful starships in the first part of the war. Although Starfleet felt challenged by these new Klingon ships, they knew they had to start really pushing back with some kind of offense. Finally, to keep the Klingons off balance, Starfleet Marines capture a Klingon world, Rugger 3, as a psychological tactic to say, yes, we can go on the offensive as well. Klingons respond to this invasion with one of the most brutal acts of the war. A dangerous nerve gas, chlorotherogen, would be used to inflict an agonizing death on the Federation ground troops there. Now, the Klingons are a relentless people, but fighting far from home, running low on replacement personnel, ships, and I would speculate most importantly, blood wine, even Klingons begin to crack. While the Federation, on the other hand, is fighting for their homes and their very survival. Finally, due to logistics, the Klingon advancement slows to a stop. Starfleet starts to actually gain the numerical advantage in most engagements. The Klingons try to regain their momentum with two desperate thrusts in the Federation space. One of these attacks was the Battle of Thranstor, where the Klingon fleet, exhausted and worn, don't even bother with any kind of fodder tactics, but instead charge right into the Federation fleet head-on. Starfleet holds fast, with the Lochnars especially making good use of their aft weaponry. The Klingons scatter among asteroids of the Thranstar system, where many smaller engagements ensue. The Starfleet ships then had to hunt down and destroy the Klingon ships hiding amongst the metal-rich asteroids. Over 100 Klingon ships were permanently disabled, and many managed to retreat back to Klingon space. A similar battle occurred near Argelius, where the Klingons threw their ragged fleet of half-repaired ships into a head-on brawl, where they were similarly defeated. The Federation finally begins to push back and take back their lost territory. One very important development would ensure a very fast pushback and eventual complete routing of the Klingon invasion fleets, and that development was phasers and photon torpedoes. By now you're writing a comment saying, but Rez, the Federation and Klingons had phase cannons and photon torpedoes and such already, according to Enterprise series. Au contraire, if we're being sticklers for canon, the first episode of Star Trek references lasers, not phasers. So in the FASA game universe, those weapons hadn't really been developed yet. And although these weapons were expensive and complex compared to the old lasers and accelerator cannons, the new science behind them meant that they could be far more versatile and destructive in application. Not every ship in Starfleet was capable of mounting these weapons, so many old designs would be retired shortly after the war, but Starfleet had already been working on developing these weapons for some years, and many of the new ships were designed with the eventual weapon upgrades in mind. Constitution, Lochnar, Anton, and Larson-class ships were all temporarily cycled off duty for the upgrades. Now the Klingons were on the back foot, and yet they continued to send new ships off the assembly line with green crews and tired commanders into the jaws of death on the Federation front. One Klingon admiral recognized that this would eventually lead to the Klingon fleet being whittled down to nothing. And without a strong defense fleet, the Empire would be vulnerable to outsiders such as Romulans, or more likely, rebel uprisings within the Empire. Admiral Comex, in his mind, to save the Empire from itself, defected to the Federation. With the help of Admiral Comex, Starfleet planned Operation Argus Redoubt, a plan to take the strategically important planet of Karag, which would have to be done with ground forces, and simultaneously a space assault against the Klingon shipyards at Grank. The Karag invasion was a long drawn-out ground battle where the Klingons would have repelled Starfleet troops with the use of chlorthagarin, the agonizing nerve gas, but the brains in Starfleet had developed an antidote. The victory at Karag against the fierce Klingon warriors was costly to Starfleet. The attack on Grank utilized captured Klingon ships, which were numerous by then. Admiral Comex was able to provide them with the proper Klingon signal IDs. Once in range, the surprise attack on the shipyards by the captured Klingon ships proceeded, while at the same time, Starfleet ships attacked from multiple vectors, putting the new phasers and photon torpedoes to good use. Very few Starfleet casualties resulted. By the time Starfleet began the final battle, involving an assault on the planet Kolm'an, there are very few Klingon ships available to resist. The Klingons instead relied on small gunboats and orbital defense stations. Starfleet attempted to capture these stations. This attempt nearly ended in disaster as the Klingons had left them on a timed self-destruct sequence. All the stations orbiting Kolm'an were destroyed by the Klingons themselves, rendering the planet defenseless for occupation. These actions forced the Klingons to the negotiation table to sue for peace. The Klingon peace delegation was rushed out to the planet where the war began, Axanar. The treaty did not strongly favor one side or the other. Instead, both sides claimed gaps of territory between the Federation and the Klingon Empire, effectively narrowing the neutral zone making the possibility of a future engagement more convenient due to proximity. But for the time being, the massive loss of life and resources on both sides meant peace was the only option. A cold war would ensue for many years after, reaching a tipping point into a hot war when Kirk commanded the Enterprise and a conflict broke out over the Klingon occupation of Organia. But since the Organians were evolved, non-corporeal beings, they intervened like parents restraining unruly children, forcing peace for another 15 years or so, until the Khitomer Accords would be signed as a result of the Praxis incident, resulting in peace between the Federation and the Klingons for years to come. So here are my final thoughts. I believe that war in Star Trek is kind of a double-edged sword. On one hand, Star Trek aspires to avoid war, and so many episodes have been made about preventing a war between the Federation and its rivals. However, war on some levels is actually a natural phenomenon. Even in our physical bodies, our immune systems are literally fighting a war against any number of destructive threats. As Sun Tzu emphasizes, we must study war, not for destruction and bloodshed, but rather as a means of preventing that destruction and bloodshed by ending a war quickly or avoiding it altogether. This concludes this series, Space Friends. If I haven't already by the time of this recording, I'll be doing some separate videos about some of the ships seen in the FASA version of the Four Years War. Be sure to look for them on my channel. Until next time!